Hello, our listeners. You're tuned into PRZ 109.2 FM. This is the Together Forever show. I'm one of your co-hosts, Victoria Ogunsanya. And I have in the studio my husband, Ade.
Hi, good evening, everyone. This is Ade, one of the co-hosts for tonight. And we are live on PRZ 109.2 FM on Together Forever show. And it's good to be back here tonight.
Yep, yes it is. We are back here Monday evenings, 8 p.m. every second and fourth Monday on the Together Forever show. And we will be continuing with what we started a couple of weeks ago, which is the topic of leaving and cleaving. And yeah, we had some fun discussing leaving and cleaving. It's all about in-laws, extended family, your family marinade, how you grew up, and understanding that now you're married, you and your wife, or you and your husband, are a new nuclear family. So we discussed the fact that there's a saying, well, it's quite universal. When people get married, they are coming into, you're joining our family, you're coming into our family. And we spoke about that even though it sounds really nice and it's very loving, that's not really the case. You're actually forming your own nuclear family. You're not really marrying into anyone's family. In fact, you're marrying into your own nuclear family. Husband and wife is a nuclear family by itself, which the mother-in-law, father-in-law, sister-in-law, big brother, which auntie, whoever raised you, they are not the head of this new setup. So that was one of the things we spoke about. And today we're going to just take it a bit further and talk about boundaries, how you should manage yourself as husband and wife now that you are married, in terms of in-laws and old life and moving away from single man, single woman to married man and woman, one flesh together. But before you go into that, I think it's helpful when you get married that you both do what you can to kind of help each other know where you're coming from, help each other know the background you're coming from, help each other know the friends that you have, help each other get to know who your family members are. And I think that will give them, it will give your spouse that opportunity to kind of start things off on the right foot, because you can't really force relationships. But at least if you've kind of helped them understand that, babe, this is my sister, this is what she likes, she's into this, if you want to annoy her, do this, if you don't want to annoy her, don't do this, this is mommy, mommy likes this kind of behavior, don't do this to mommy, she doesn't really appreciate that. Oh, if you really want to impress mommy, talk to her about this. You know, we should give our spouse those kind of winning tips. For instance, I'll use an example. Let's say there's two friends, best friends, one has a job in, let's say, BT or whatever, and they've been there a while and they're doing well. And then their friend manages to get a job there. And because they're friends and they care about each other, the friend that is already working there, it should be right for them to say, do you know what? The boss that you have, this person, Steve or whatever his name would be, he's really good. He likes this. He's into politics. If you can speak to him about this, if you can have a meeting with him about this, don't really go to this person. Do you know your friend, you know where you're working, and you can kind of help them to ease themselves in the best way that they can. And you're giving them that advantage, that insider advantage. So I think as husbands and wives, we can also do the same thing, because we know our family, right? And we know our spouse, but they may not know each other very well. So we should do our best to kind of bridge that gap and help everyone feel comfortable. What would you say to that, babe?
Yeah, I quite understand where you're coming from. And then it's not that easy. Even the husband or the man or the woman that you just married, you still have to study him. Talk less of your in-laws.
Yes.
So it's a gradual process. It's something, not just something that's going to be within 2 months, 3 months, you know they know. It's going to be something you have to be learning. Your husband or your wife can even help you along the line. Oh, this is what my sister likes, this is what my brother likes, this is what my mom likes, and all that. But along with that, you too, you have to do your own job. You have to study them, know what they like. Okay, yes, this is what they like. Yeah, and from there, you'll be able to build a better relationship with them. Even your husband or your wife, you're still studying him or her. So, but along the line, you have to study all of them together and then make sure you make everything work.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, you can't please everyone all the time. That's just the truth of it. And as we spoke about the other time, your husband, your wife is now your priority. And rightfully you said, babe, you have to get to know your spouse. And that's what it says in the Bible. You dwell with your wife according to knowledge. So I believe that knowledge is an ongoing knowledge. It's not really let me know what I need to know. Oh, yeah, she's a good girl. Marry her. Fine. Not really. It's kind of saying that in order for you to dwell with this person and it works, you're going to have to keep getting to know them. And there are levels of intimacy. So, yeah, keep going, not just after you're married. No, it doesn't stop there. There are so many things that we can learn about each other every day if we take the time to. So it's about continuing getting to know each other. What would you say?
Yeah, like I said initially, you have to keep on learning. You have to keep on studying. When you are in a relationship with your spouse, the level of intimacy is something that you have to build, or you have to work on gradually every day. So also, no matter how long you've been in the relationship, you can't even know your spouse, you can't know your wife, you can't know your husband until you started living together as husband and wife.
Yeah.
That is when you say, okay, yes, so this is what this woman is like, this is what this man is like. And from there, when you see him every day, you see her every day, this is what she like, this is what she like eating, this is how she wanted it, how she does it, then from there you'll be able to build it, and then till you get to where you're going. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah, because I mean, how much can you really get to know each other while you're courting? When they say, there's a marriage counselor, a great marriage counselor, goes by the name of Hassani Pettiford. He says something which really makes me laugh, but it's so true. He said, love is blind, but marriage will open up both your eyes. What do you think about that?
that's quite funny. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, love is blind. That's, everybody will say it. Love is blind. Until you enter into it, that's when you know, oh, yes, definitely love is not really blind. It's not
what... Should have gone to Specsavers.
Yeah, it's not what they said it is, but... love is something that is good, is something that is lovable, is something that you have to cherish for you to make your relationship or your marriage work better. You just have to love each other, you have to love one another. And then you said we're talking about boundary. What do you mean by boundary? Is it boundary between husband and wife, or boundary between the in-laws and between your in-laws?
Boundary, that's a good question. I wouldn't really say there should be boundaries between husband and wife. I mean, okay, maybe slight boundaries. I mean, some people are really intimate people. They're vulnerable. They're like, this is me, everything. Husband and wife go to toilet together. They don't mind. Some people are a bit more reserved. But apart from those kind of boundaries, then I don't really think there are any boundaries between husband and wife that should be there. Apart from the fact that people open up at different rates. So it might be that it feels like there's a boundary. It's not necessarily a boundary or a don't go there area, but it just means that we open up at different levels, and you might need to take some time. So just kind of be patient. I mean, I know for me, I'm very like, this is me. I can be vulnerable with somebody that I'm close to. So maybe my husband, maybe he thought, hey, someone is a bit more sure. She's just, this is her. This is everything about her. Just bam. And he's maybe a bit more reserved. So I had to kind of learn that, do you know what? You need to be a bit patient, because we're all different. We open up at different levels. My personality is more out there, bubbly, talk all the time, even talk when it's not necessary, which even that I've had to work with. And my husband's personality has helped me to work with that. So yeah, sometimes we just need to be patient and learn each other. Like you said, marriage, you learn a lot. We learn a lot the first year of marriage, second year of marriage, third year of marriage. It's like, now we're kind of really like, okay, this is who he is, this is who she is. But it takes forever. And your spouse's parents, their siblings, they've got that upper advantage. They know them from birth. They know what they like. So you can't really, you can't compete with them and think that, oh, you're going to just know everything about them at once. No, it doesn't work that way. It took a lifetime for them to get that, that intimacy and just that realness and being vulnerable, not having to pretend that they're close. They're just being themselves. So I would say give yourself time. But yeah, you do need boundaries. I would say boundaries. What would be a good boundary? So something like this. Let's say you marry somebody. They're very, very close to their parents. They're very, very close to their siblings. Especially if, let's say, their parents are their leaders in the church. So naturally, they're used to going to their parents when something doesn't go well at work or something doesn't go well with a friend. And they might feel tempted to kind of do the same when they're married. So maybe let's say husband and wife have a disagreement. Because that parents have always played the role of advisor, they might feel tempted to kind of share it with them. And I would say you need to kind of be careful with stuff like that. And that is where you might need a boundary. What do you think about that, babe?
Yeah, when you said boundary between husband and wife, as a man, you have to know your role. As a woman, you have to know your role and you have to play it. And then you said if there is an issue between husband and wife or they have a disagreement, that's why marriage is not for boys. Like I said in our last discussion, now marriage is not for boys and it's not for girls. If you have a disagreement, then you just have to sort it out within yourself. You don't have to go to your father or go out to your mother and discuss, oh, this is what happened in our family, this is what my wife did to me, this is what my husband did to me. Mm-hmm. You just have to find a way of the two of you coming together, sit down, what happened, how can we go about it, then make it resolve it. And then if it happens that it's something that is taking long, it's dragging, and that's when you can seek for advice. And you don't just have to go to when you're seeking for advice, you don't have to necessarily go to your father or your mom. You can go to a marriage counselor. You can go to your pastors or someone that you know is respected, or your wife will respect, or your husband will respect. And okay, this is what we're having, and then we don't want it to go more beyond this. Mm. That's why we're coming to you. So you don't have to discuss everything that happens between in your marriage with your parents or with your in-law. It's not advisable because if, for example, if anything happened now and I went to my father, I'm a son, he can give me advice that will be, because I'm a son, it's more personal,
yeah,
compared to the, which is more, it's going to be biased. Yeah. So that's why it's not advisable to go to your parents for in such situation.
Yeah, that's true, and I do agree with that. But what about where it's a case where, okay, so they know their child. They know their child. They know, our daughter, she comes to us whenever. And husband and wife, they've just had big, big, big argument on the way to church. They enter. And mommy and daddy, they know their child. They can see it all over their face. Doom, doom, doom. What's happened? What has got? And they know something's gone on. Do you still have to tell them, or?
Yeah, you wouldn't have to lie to them. You said, "Oh, we just have a little disagreement," and that's it. You don't have to go further than that. Except even if they pester you to say, oh, "Open up," you just say, "Whoa, it doesn't matter. We have to set to it." You just have to see how you can put. I wouldn't say a barrier, wise. But you just have to be wise. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in dealing with your in-laws or with your parents in your marriage, because it can backfire on you.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And it's about what you said in terms of they might give biased advice, because let's say something has happened and the thing is quite serious. Naturally, they don't want somebody hurting their child. They just don't want it. No parent wants that. And especially when they're still getting to know that wife, or they're still getting to know that husband. So they know this is our son-in-law, but they haven't yet felt that full love for them. Like, this is our son. We see our son the same as our own daughter. It might take a while, and you don't want to just now give them a warped view, or a view of that son-in-law or daughter-in-law that they haven't had before. And also, by the time you guys go home and you settle it, sometimes people, they don't, they have disagreements. I've had friends come to me, right? They tell me their disagreement. You give them advice. You'll be like, ah, did that happen? And of course you're upset. You'll be thinking, why did they do this? Why did they do that? You might give them the advice or whatever. And they don't tell you what happens next. You just know they're getting on with whoever they're getting on with. They don't come and tell you that, actually, we sorted it out. I realized I too was at fault and we've sorted it out. Thank you very much. They don't tell you that. And the last impression you have is that this person has done something to the person you love. So we ourselves, do we go back and even defend the spouse later on? No, we don't do that. We're just like, we've made up, and yeah, and they're left with that image. So next time you're bringing something to them, they've got that image of this person that did this. So yeah, it's very, very important that we don't say what we don't need to say, because it can backfire and it won't help build that healthy relationship between the two of them. Yeah.
Even when you go to counselor or your pastor, you just have to be wise as well. You don't have to say, okay, this is what my pastor said, this is what the counselor said, and you acted upon it. You have to weigh it as well, think about it. Or your pastor, I'm not saying your pastor might be right, the counselor might be right, but you just have to, that's when you apply your own wisdom to it and say, because you know your spouse,
yeah,
you know who you are dealing with. It is from there you'll be able to carry out, okay, yes, okay, if I go this way, I go this way, then you're able to sort it out. And from there, because like I said, there's no perfect marriage. No matter the anointing, no matter how long you've been married, there will be challenges, there will be argument, and you just have to find a way of sorting it out. And then your parents or your brother-in-law, they might not be the best at that point in time. You just have to look for external people who is not going to cite maybe the man or the husband, then the man or the wife. Yeah,
which is very difficult to do. Even so-called counselors that are not partial, because let's say the counselor I go to, they're from the same cultural background as me. By the time I've told them the story, they're like, what? This is unacceptable, because we have the same cultural background. They understand where I'm coming from. Already, they've kind of, before they've even heard the other side, they're like, this is not really. So yeah, it is hard to find somebody that is balanced. But I like what you said, my husband, in the sense that you need to weigh that advice, weigh it with the word of God, weigh it with prayer. So go there with a humble heart, ready to be taught, but weigh it with prayer. And yeah, you know your spouse, so you know what's gonna work after the end of that advice. And I really like what you said in terms of find someone that they respect. I think that is really, really key. You don't want to be going to somebody that you know doesn't like them, is going to take your side. That's just going to add fire to the fuel. You don't want to do that. So somebody that they respect. Yeah, so yeah, that is one way where I think a boundary should definitely be established. Can you think of any other areas?
I don't know about boundary about in-laws, where your in-laws will come to your house and then they will keep on raising issues or something that is not, or you are, as a couple, you didn't even think, or it's something, but they'll pick it up, and then from there it's going to be another problem.
Yeah.
So how do you solve that? How do you resolve it?
I'd say with wisdom. There's something that you mentioned the other time we had our show, and you said, it might be worth kind of having a meeting between the two of you guys and just talking about what is a decent time for somebody to come and stay with you. Is it 2 weeks? Is it 6 months? People are different in terms of what they like. Relationships are different. So it's good to kind of establish those boundaries. But if you're already having these conversations, when it happens, then you kind of know that, oh, do you know what? Just let mommy, daddy talk. They just like giving their opinion. It's nothing more than that. They're not saying we're bad parents. They're not saying we don't know how to make decisions. They're just giving their general opinion as, oh, this is their grandchild. And if you see it that way, it's not going to be a big issue. But if you already are feeling insecure about your parenting, or you feel that your spouse is not really, they're not really appreciating you as a parent, then it might be that thing when it's said, you may feel this thing a bit more because you yourself are not sure. So it's good for you guys to be on the same page, I say, try and be on the same page with your kids in terms of how you want to discipline them, what you want to do for them. Because a lot of the times grandparents might say, you are spoiling this child, or even the other way, you are being too harsh. So what do you guys agree as first? That way, when they're saying it, you can even kind of make it like a gist that, oh, mommy or daddy, and it's not going to offend anybody because you're both on the same page.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. A boundary, there should be a boundary between the husband and between your in-laws, you and your in-law, between both the couples and their in-laws, because we've seen marriages being broken or relationship being destroyed because as a result of the in-laws, where the mother-in-law might come and said, oh, she'll be noticing, she might say, oh, your wife is so lazy, your wife is dirty. In as much the husband or the wife doesn't complain, I don't think, even if you notice as a mother-in-law, as a father-in-law, you don't have to complain, you don't have to raise an alarm. Even as much as it pleases the two of them, then it's between them. It's not your home. It is their own home. You're just here for the maybe for a couple of days, and then you've gone. So you don't have to raise it up and say, which is going to cause problem between the marriage of your children. So that's why I say there should be a boundary. And then as a father and as mother-in-law, when you go to your son and daughters-in-law, you just don't have to stay long. Yeah, stay for a few days, 2 weeks maximum, you go. Then even you can come back some other time, but if the more you stay, the more you notice one problem or the other, and then from there it's gonna be it might be, you know, a big problem for the marriage.
Wow. The more you stay, the more you notice. I didn't really think of it that way, but it's true, because this is an intimate setting that you've come into as an outsider. Even though you're mum or dad, you actually are an outsider now. Sorry to say, I know it might sound a bit, but it's not really your home. So because it's not your home, naturally you're gonna even notice things that maybe are even in your house, but because it's not even your house, you're more aware. And the longer you stay, the more you see and you feel you need to talk. So yeah, I guess it takes training. I mean, I'm taking notes, mental notes here, that when my son and my daughters get married, that I won't be doing all of this. I pray God would help me.
Amen. Yeah, even apart from you being your son and daughter being married, even a father going to his son as a single person, you will still find fault. Oh, my son, this is where your shoe is supposed to be. This is where you have to put your socks. As that's single man or single girl, single woman, talk less of you going to a family with which they are couples, or most especially if they are just married. I don't think it's really advisable. Yeah, but though it happens, and then you just and even if it happens, you just have to find a way to manage it. No matter what, find a way to get out of it. Yeah.
To get out of it, I mean, I would say pray, because the thing is, mummy and daddy, I'm not sure they would necessarily mean all these things. It's just out of love and them thinking, oh, this can be better, our suggestion can be better. But yeah, so what I would say is, what would I say? Pray about it and discuss it with your spouse. If you feel it's getting too much, you guys sit down, maybe when mommy and daddy have slept, and just say, oh, I don't really like this. And even by the time you guys have kind of spoken it out, you can be like, okay, mommy, daddy won't be here long. Is this something that we need to talk, or is this something that we don't really need to talk? And by the time you've spoken to your spouse, you'll know which one it is. Yeah. And God will help you through it. What about celebrations? So let's say somebody marries a family, the spouse of a family that's very, very close. They do birthdays together, they do celebrations together, and they always do everything together. And the son has now gone and married somebody that they're not that close to their family, and they don't mind seeing their family all the time, and they're quite independent. How do you work that out?
Yeah, you just have to tell your spouse, and then, oh, that's how I was brought up. This is how we grew up together, and then this is what we do. Though it might be strange to you, but you just have to let her know that, oh, it's something that is fun. It's something that, oh, you just have to enjoy. From you, you telling your spouse that you have to build a, you tell her to open up. he or she open up, then he will be able to feel be among or belong to the family. Because you said, oh yes, I wasn't brought up this way. I don't like it. I don't like people coming around. But that's what you married into. You just have to, that's part of the cleaving that you have to bear with. You just have to play along with it, and then I'm sure you will enjoy. Even you seeing other families doing this different things together. I remember when I think the last Christmas when we traveled together to see our families. I believe though we were so many that I believe it's quite enjoyable, and I believe despite the fact that you are now you don't see family often. you still enjoy it despite the fact that we are many in the house.
Expose. Yes, personal testimony. No, it was wonderful because I've always wanted this big family, but then at the same time I was like, but how is it gonna be everybody just there all the time? But it was good, and I'm grateful to my husband because he helped me walk through it. And I think it's not really about pressurizing, like you said. Give them the grace to kind of bring them along and show them why it's fun, but also give yourself liberty to actually have your own tradition. So do a bit of what they do a bit of what the other side do, but also you guys can actually make your own traditions, because remember, you're a whole new nuclear family and you can kind of put your twist on things. So balance, let everybody feel loved, but you can't please everybody all the time. And I think we've run out of time again. This time just runs out.
Just like that.
Wow. Yeah. So we'll be back again in another 2 weeks, every Monday, 8 p.m. No, not every Monday. We wish it was every Monday, but we can't do every Monday. Every second and fourth Monday at 8 p.m. on PRZ FM 109.2. This is your host, Victoria Ogunsanya.
And I'm Ade Ogunsanya.
And remember, together we are stronger.